It's a great pleasure for me to be here this morning and to do this presentation on South Africa's quest for ethics. I thought it's a big topic because one of the things that one has to think about is how old is South Africa? Is it 100 years old? Is it 25 years old? Is it 2 days old? Or is it just over a year old? Or maybe a couple of months old? Because we've just had a new president, the fifth or sixth administration. The new administration. Still the one ruling party, the South African National Congress, the ANC, which of course a lot of us hold dear in our hearts for the work that they did, as well as the African countries, the role that they played to bring us to where we are today. So it's a big question, it's a big ask. And why should we be worrying about ethics? Why in the news, why in the headlines? In fact, I have a paper that I thought, should I bring this headline or should I leave it? I thought, let me leave it. Let me not bring it and show it to my colleagues here, because maybe you've just seen it. It came out on Thursday, and the headline in one of the papers, The Star. And it's a sad story. And it's a story that tells just how far or how young we are as a nation, as a country. I'm going to stick to the time. I do tend to speak quite a lot, and I like energy. So I may ask you to join my energy as we do this, because energy is what drives me. And I think ethics are driven by energetic people. Yeah? That's what I think. You may not have the energy, but you can still try the energy. But that's just my thing. Now, survey after survey that comes out, just as a side note, and there's a global survey that came out on ethics this month, the 2019 Global Afrobarometer or Global Survey on Ethics. And interestingly, when you look at the countries, how we rank, it's actually quite astonishing. In South Africa at the moment, one of the states that I'll show, let's see, is this the way forward? That's the way forward. Okay, that's the way forward. So that's the content, that's what I'd like to cover this morning. Just the history, the context I've already started on the history. The movement against unethical conduct, what's happening right now. Key institution enhancing ethical conduct, visible drive for integrity and ethical conduct in South Africa, and then in conclusion. So it's not going to be a long presentation. I know that our chairman, Alex, is doing a good job in making sure that we keep to the thing, we keep to the task. This is what I mean. Unethical conduct or corruption is a deliberate act or process of breaking a system. When a system of checks and balances is broken, someone stands to benefit. So there are people who would like to see this thing continue because a broken system benefits someone. You would be amazed today in Zim, there are people who are making millions out of the system that is broken that hopefully the new government is going to try and rebuild. So someone benefits from corruption or from unethical behavior. That's why it's there. That's why it gets entrenched and it's getting difficult to remove. 54% of South Africans are back. Where is that stat? Somewhere I have a stat here, which says only 54% of South Africans believe that our government, the government that liberated us, the people who went into exile, some of them, the people who died for the struggle, only 54% of the population at the moment believe that things should change. 54% of the people think they can personally change the ethical conduct of what's happening in South Africa. A little bit of history. So are we old or young? This is 1990. Mandela comes out of, I don't know if you can see, but there is standing there. And there is the new president. There is a content this thing. There is Mandela. There is Cyril Ramaphosa. A young Cyril Ramaphosa. And of course, the rest of the crowd there. The number of people that were important in the struggle. 1990, the guy comes out of prison, as you know, and he starts ruling the country. And a lot of things change. And of course, his brother, as I said, the Syrian now, is in control, is in charge of the country. Now, in South Africa, one of the things that you hear people saying, we have lost some years because of our, in the 25 years, only 25 years old. So we've just come out of the teenage years, and we have to rebuild and bring ethics. So, you know the history. So he comes out and the people say he's going to rule the country, and that's what happened. So we have the crowds and say he must be president. And indeed, the history does tell us. That's 1994, the elections. These are the people today, 54% of them say we can change the dynamics of our ethics in our country to make South Africa a winning nation. We can do it. The people who went to vote. But what tends to happen is that, of course, because as I've said earlier, that someone benefits from other unethical conduct, and they want to keep the system there. It's a big ask. You can have the majority, but the majority sometimes, and some of these liberals and Democrats will tell you, sometimes the majority is not very, very bright, some of the politicians tell us. And so maybe they say that because we are afraid to stand up and to fight the majority. This is one thing that I say. I say I like working in an environment where there's a trade union. Right? I worked in a plant where there was a trade union. As an HR manager myself, the workers kidnapped me and said, you are not going home today, sir. Because there's nonsense going on in this plant. Therefore, no one is going home. They locked the gate. They locked the management in. I was looking for a part manufacturing company. But I like trade unions because strong trade unions that understand business, understand where we're supposed to go as a business. They don't allow, and we see that, I'm showing you a slide later on, we see that right now in South Africa again. When they see that management, the leaders are not going the right way, they tell the leaders. So that kidnapping was not about we're going to kill you, it's about, but we have been telling you, our HR manager has been saying to you, this is not on. And you come back and tell us that now management, this management, that. So why are you guys taking the company? So today we resolve this problem. So no one, we're not going to our families, you're not going to your own families. In one of the minds recently, or as recently as June, one of the managers, the so-called supervisors, chased a woman miner down the shaft, seeking to have sexual intercourse with her. So a month ago, remember, this incident happened over a year ago, but last month the union said, this case, why is this case not going anywhere? So they decided to stay under the mine and not come out. I picked up the phone as the CEO of the IPM and called the HR manager. Was in the paper it said, and HR did nothing. But of course, for my profession, for our profession, I felt, I felt a lot of, I was being undermined by the certainty. If there's an HR department, we can't be classified as an HR did nothing. It's bad headline. That was in the Soweto riots, if I didn't see. And I called him and said, Luma, what's going on here? Of course, the media will sometimes sensationalize things. So it was a sensational story. He said, no, let me tell you what we've done. Let me tell you where the case is. But here is the point. The point is that it took a trade union. It said, human rights and women rights are rights. We're now going to take this matter up and deal with it. So that's why I say sometimes why call our workers ourselves? Sometimes we allow rubbish to go on. Hence, unethical conduct. I mean, we have, as the speakers yesterday said, one of the things that happens is that we see what is happening, but we are not, we just keep ducking and diving. Sometimes we've got to stand up. And when you stand up, it's difficult. It's going to be difficult, but you've got to stand up. And that's what us as HR big professionals and managers are supposed to do. Standing up is hard. And not to blow my own horn, but in an organization, if you remain nameless, which was fined, I worked for this organization, was fined, the international office was fined $300 million for unethical conduct. You can guess, if you look at my city, you can guess which kind of companies made that kind of money. Then you can find out. Now, I stood up against my own CEO in this organization, in the subsidiary, and I said, sir, but we cannot be doing some of the things that are happening here. You know what happened? Some of the workers wondered, because it became clear, and you can't go, sometimes when you go against your CEO, in terms of decision making, of course you do it privately, you do it maturely, but you know that the relationship is going to struggle for a while.
you're going to start to make that relationship work, to rebuild, for this person to recover, because I'm the boss.
For a couple of months, it was clear, and the staff could see, this guy doesn't want to hear. Why are you speaking? I said, and this is what I charge you. You see, in HR, for us to excel and to drive ethics, one of the things that we must know why we're in that job. Sometimes you get too desperate for jobs that you can't, our voice doesn't get heard. Our voice must be heard. So I said to the staff, I'm happy that you're sympathizing with me. But this is what I believe about my job. I believe in a superpower. So I believe that God puts you in a job for a purpose. You don't leave just because someone says it's time for you to leave. You leave, you pray about the staff, and at some point you do feel like it is time to go. Because there's an alignment with that. So that's it to the staff, guys, don't worry. I'll be fine. I 5 minutes, eh? Thank you. So these are key institutions that drive good governance in our country at the moment. That's parliament. And our parliament has changed. You can see it's changed. You can see the guys with the red overalls, the EFF. And they've changed the dynamics of what's happening there. They are young. And of course, it's a multi-party democracy. You have the DA there, the Democratic Alliance, you have the ANC, the ruling party, you have the EFF, you have the NFP, you have other smaller parties. And our parliament has not been the same since the other administration because of the dynamism that the young people are bringing. And of course, the thing that the ruling party itself, where the youth being brought in, because that's what we should be doing, in fact, in our own organizations, the IPL, this organization here, the Malawi, we must be recruiting younger people to re-energize our organizations. And of course, to ensure that there's succession planning. So these are the people that are key